Tonight, a grand jury begins hearing the Botham Jean case in Dallas, Texas. Kimberly DeLeon is laid to rest as demands for justice for the slain mother grow louder. The psychological and social well-being of persons living with HIV and TB to get priority. And the Independence Committee plans an entire year of activities to mark the island's 40th independence anniversary. Very good evening to you. Welcome to the Monday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. A Dallas County jury began hearing evidence today against a Dallas police officer who shot and killed St. Lucien Botham Jean in his own apartment while he was watching a football game, according to a law enforcement official with knowledge of the case. Amber Geiger, 30, was arrested on a manslaughter charge September the 9th, 3 days after killing 26-year-old Jean. She told authorities that she mistook his apartment for hers on the night of September the 6th and thought he was a burglar. According to Dallas News, attorneys for the Jean family, Lee Merritt and Daryl K. Washington, confirmed that the Jean family was in Dallas in case they were called upon to testify before the grand jury. The attorney said they would be surprised if the grand jury heard evidence beyond Wednesday.
This is an indictment that is highly anticipated by an international community, from St. Lucia to all the islands in the West Indies to England or London, where Botham's company was based out of. We receive inquiries daily about when this indictment was going to take place. And so not only is his family anticipating, but the world is watching, and this is a very important decision for Dallas County.
And what we know is that Botham was lawfully in his apartment on that night that he was killed. This officer was able to find her keys. She was able to locate her car. She was able to locate the direction back to her apartment complex, but somehow she couldn't find her apartment. And these are answers, I think, that the grand jury is going to want to know. They're going to want to hear. Whether or not this officer is going to testify before the grand jury is probably doubtful. But I think the investigation will show that at the moment that Botham was killed, he wasn't committing any penal offenses. And because of that, it has always been our belief that murder is the proper charge.
The grand jury could indict Geiger for a manslaughter charge, but could also decide murder is the more appropriate charge. Geiger could also face no charges in Jean's death. In Texas, manslaughter is considered a reckless act. If Geiger intended to shoot Jean, even if she wrongly thought he was a burglar, murder is the more appropriate charge, Dallas defense attorneys have said. Relatives of Kimberly William DeLeon appeared more optimistic than ever about her murder case as the leader remains to rest today. Relatives, friends, and well-wishers gathered at the Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception to say their final farewell. The 42-year-old mother of two was gunned down in her home at Mount Fortune on October 29, 2018. No arrests have been made and investigations continue, but relatives remain optimistic her killer will be brought to justice. Sheffield Gillard reports.
A few major streets in Castries were lined with orange, purple, and pink balloons Monday ahead of the funeral service, the colors signifying that a victim of domestic abuse has died.
It is also a call to everyone to play their part in fighting domestic violence against women, against anyone, as a matter of fact. It also brings into reality what is actually happening now, that we should all come together as a family, as a country, and see how we could make a difference, how we could fight this this horrible thing that is happening with regards to domestic violence.
The screams could be heard from outside the church as loved ones struggle to come to terms with the loss.
At this time, as we lift our voices and sing in praise and adoration to you, this is my prayer.
Thank you.
just a bit of all mixed emotions, anger at the moment. I guess, what can I say, but just total disbelief as to what is actually happening now.
Various organizations were represented, including the past students of the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School, which Kimberly graduated from, and the students of the Camille Henry Memorial School, which her two children attend.
Look to this day, for it is life,
the very life of life.
In its brief course, like all the verities and realities of your existence, the bliss of growth,
the glory of action,
the splendor of achievements. For yesterday is but a dream,
and tomorrow is only a vision.
But today, well lived, makes every yesterday a dream of happiness, and every tomorrow a vision of hope. Look well, therefore,
to this day.
Such is the salutation of the dawn.
A postmortem revealed that De Leon died from a single gunshot to the head. While no arrests have been made, relatives remain optimistic that they will get justice.
This is a special case, as this case can make or break the police, and I believe it's a special case and justice will be served.
Just last week, Police Commissioner Severin Morcheri said that investigators would have an update on samples sent overseas for testing by this week. Lawmen hope the results will shed light on the case. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, the slow recovery of small island states from natural disasters was a focus for Prime Minister Alan Chastain as he attended a high-level one-day conference in Washington, D.C. today. The conference was held under the theme, Building Resilience to Disasters and Climate Change in the Caribbean. Here is Don Nicholas.
The one-day conference held in Washington, D.C. was organized by the International Monetary Fund, IMF, and the World Bank. Prime Minister Alan Chastain participated in several panel discussions. One of his main concerns is the recovery time for small island states following disasters. Officials say there's too much bureaucracy retarding the process.
One of these major issues is access to funding. A lot of times after or with regard to natural disasters, the Caribbean finds it hard to access funding which is meant for disaster relief in our territories. So this is some of the issues that we will be highlighting. The fact that it takes too long, there's a lot of bureaucracy in terms of being able to access funds for you to recover quickly.
Following his stint as OECS chairman, Prime Minister Chastain received praise from his counterparts for strongly advocating for climate change resilience.
The Prime Minister will be participating in a panel on shifting the focus towards building resilience. We also have another panel discussion on the way forward. There are several other Prime Ministers from the region who will also be participating in this high-level conference that is very important in terms of some of the issues we face in the region.
The senior communications officer says the slow process is hurting the Caribbean, especially the OECS sub-region. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The psychological and social well-being of persons living with HIV and TB is expected to be improved as the OECS works towards supporting these services. Fennell Neptune has more.
Efforts at developing a framework to strengthen mental health and psychosocial support for persons living with HIV and TB, their partners, families, and caregivers is ongoing as a two-day workshop was held recently. Workshop facilitator Patricia Isaac Joseph emphasize that psychosocial support for HIV patients is necessary as it will help them with coping and adhering to treatment.
As part of the Global Fund grant, which the OECS countries are a recipient of, it's really looking at how, what are some of the issues that come out of getting a diagnosis of HIV or TB, and what are some of the support systems that we need to put in place to help persons, you know, just work through the process and to be able to live with the condition as well as to stick to the treatment that they are being given.
physician of the Infectious Diseases Unit in the Department of Health and Wellness, Dr. Gil Kajada, says providing assistance is crucial in reducing the psychological distress for persons coping with HIV and TB diagnosis.
A person who is diagnosed with TB, the first 2 months of their illness, they are infectious, so they are isolated. And I think most of us know the isolation unit is the chest wing at Victoria Hospital. When you are isolated, you cannot work. You are out of work, and some persons may end up losing their job over that. Some persons may end up losing their home over that. So we need to have some form of assistance to at least allow those persons to manage their bills, their families, whatever it is that's going on there during that period. So I'm just highlighting an example of what happens or what can happen if you don't have support whilst you're isolated for that 2 month period.
The workshop was made possible by the Global Fund for the OECS HIV-TB Elimination Project. Reporting from the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Health and Wellness, I am Fennel Neptune.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Buske, and you're watching Street Vibes. In light of the recent fire to one of the historical townhouses on Broglie and Marion Streets, don't you think it's about time that the government implements some sort of halfway house to house the homeless?
Somebody could put something in place. It don't have to be government. Somebody who is wealthy enough could find a place where these people can have a proper night's sleep. And then you wouldn't have them kind of problems happening in town again, people catching some place at 5 in the morning. So that would be something good, at least you would feel good about doing something. Not only the Salvation Army has to do good things. Somebody with money can do something good too.
It's our civil responsibility to shelter and take after those who are less fortunate, those who are mentally challenged. So I think that's very much in order. That's not a big ask to have a housing for the vagrants and the homeless people who are on our streets. And that would cater well for the environment, the society, and the whole. Yeah.
There are times the government will prepare something so for them people. And some of them will still leave the place and just come around and do endless magic. Now, when you prepare a place so for people, remember you have to pay people to check on them people. Now, them people just do a lot of nastiness and they're okay. So it's not, we don't blame the government. We only blame we, the people.
I believe they should have a halfway house to help those who cannot help themselves, because sometimes they have no families and they need help. Also, for the abandoned buildings in St. Lucia, the people who are responsible for it should be able to demolish these things and do something better with it. If not, just demolish it and know that the place is clear, that they will not have nobody to smoke or to drink in these places.
I think it is time, not it's time, I think it's long overdue that we should become more sympathetic to homeless people and do all we can in our powers. I'm sure we can do something to first stem the problem that caused those people to arrive or become those kind of people in our society. There's a reason for that, okay? But however, having said that, some people will always fall through the crack. And we must try to rehabilitate them, okay? Not only to just have a halfway house where you just chuck them there, but to see how we can re-energize their mind so that they can return to the society to produce and help the country, because something can be done.
You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
Thank you very much. You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, members of the public invited to contribute to ideas to mark the island's 40th independence anniversary. And the 33rd edition of the Atlantic Rally for Cruisers gets underway. Welcome back, and thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. The Independence Planning Committee is calling on members of the public to share their ideas on activities to celebrate St. Lucia's 40th independence anniversary. The committee is hoping to host an entire year of activities to mark the milestone. Don Nicholas reports.
Activities organized by the Independence Planning Committee to mark St. Lucia's 40th independence anniversary get underway on December 12, 2018 and will run until December 12, 2019. 40 influential people will be recognized and 40 events will be organized. The committee is encouraging the public to get involved in the planning. Persons interested in coming forward with ideas can contact the planning committee at the Parliament building.
We also want to provide opportunities for maximum economic spin-offs for our vendors, our artists, taxi drivers, hoteliers, anybody that can participate in it, our artists in the whole of independence for 1 year.
We want to celebrate our St. Lucianness in a very unique way. There's a lot to celebrate after 40 years, and we're looking to encompass every sector and every aspect of our society in St. Lucia, in all the diasporas, from the Caribbean to North, South America, to England, to Canada.
Member of the committee, Jeshron Andrew, who is also the president of the National Youth Council, is happy that the youth have been included. Youth Parliament will be held in February and in April, which is designated Youth Month. Next year's Independence Day celebration promises to be one with a difference. Activities to mark the occasion start from the night of February 21st.
We're going to see where we trace the evolution of St. Lucia from creation until contemporary society. And apart from that, we're going to be showcasing the best of St. Lucia, the best of St. Lucia in terms of music. In terms we have, we're going to cover all the major genres of music, and we're going to be seeing traditional, folk, calypso, soca, everyone, etc., included in this evening. So hence, it will end with a fireworks display, really ushering in and for us to celebrate what was really our independence anniversary. The next day, which is the 22nd, again, we'll have people going home and waiting to see what the next day will bring. And we really want to start off the day on a very good note. We will have our address from our Prime Minister, and we will have the police is going to put on a display that I don't think anyone would want to miss.
During the 39th celebrations, we attempted to execute an activity dubbed Strides of Unity. However, due to certain circumstances, we were unable to at that point in time. But we are happy to say today that this will be executed for the 40th celebration of independence. And for those who may be wondering, Strides of Unity is supposed to be a youth unity run around the island.
Advertisements will highlight independence activities for each week. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The National Workers Union and the government negotiating team have agreed to a $1,000 lump sum payment to daily paid government employees before Christmas. The decision was reached at a meeting between the two entities last week. Here is Don Nicholas with the details.
Non-established workers, daily paid workers, watchmen, constituency councils, health aides, and other workers in the bargaining unit will enjoy the $1,000 payout. The National Workers Union held a 2.5-hour meeting with the government negotiating team to discuss the matter. The payment will be made before Christmas 2018.
During that meeting, we were able to come up with an agreement as it relates to the NW's proposal for a lump sum payout to its members before Christmas. The figure agreed to was $1,000. The shop stewards were part of the entire process, so they got a chance to see the back and forth and give their input.
The following day, the government met with daily paid workers to inform them of the arrangement.
The NW had a meeting of all of its daily paid shop stewards the following day, and everybody was in agreement, also remembering that we got that mandate from our people to submit that proposal on their behalf to the government negotiating team.
The next meeting between the National Workers Union and the government negotiating team to discuss other matters will be in January 2019. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The National Consumer Association is concerned about reports of false advertising and price gouging. Consumers claim that merchants inflated their original prices on items to make the advertised deals look better and to trick consumers into thinking they were getting huge discounts when they weren't. Sheffield Gellard has that story.
While every consumer would like to get a good deal when shopping, how do they really know that a discount given is actually a discount? Social media was flooded with irate customers over the weekend following Black Friday sales around the island. During such an event, different retailers often boast of huge discounts, which turn out not to be as huge after all. The National Consumer Association has received numerous reports about that practice.
We are totally against that. I think the people in question will have to make sure that they do their things properly and do not mislead the public. And that's what we're going to stand down for these things, and we're going to stand against these things.
Mr. Modest says the association is not against St. Lucia adopting a metropolitan culture. However, it must be done right. He has called on consumers to be more vigilant when shopping and not be fooled by unscrupulous retailers.
Those responsible or some of the places that you have found that where this thing has surfaced, definitely they have a different mindset on how they do things. And they have to realize that the public is an educated public. They know what is happening. They have to look for about their interests, because if they don't look about their interests, who's going to, you know? While we are on their side, but at the same time, they must do something for their own self. I think next year, they must make sure that they don't do these kind of things anymore. And people must be vigilant when they go in and shop, even around this Christmas time.
The department is encouraging the general public to report such cases to the Consumer Affairs Department at the Department of Commerce. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The 33rd edition of the Atlantic Rally for Cruisers, ARC, sailed off on Sunday, along with the local flotilla held to coincide with the start of the transatlantic race. Every November since 1986, the Atlantic Rally for Cruisers has set sail from Las Palmas. Alex Bosque tells us more.
The start of the transatlantic rally was matched by simultaneous hosting of the customary ARC flotilla here in St. Lucia. Boats sailed from the IGY Marina to the Castries Harbour, at which point the local boats circled the inner port of Castries, awaiting the sound of the horn, which would signal that the rally had started in Spain. It was a fun-filled afternoon and the weather held up, contributing to what was surely a beautiful nautical sight for those watching from on shore. On arrival at Rodney Bay, some boats chose to stay on anchor while others participated in the festivities at the marina.
The flotilla is just ceremonial. It is symbolic as the end point of the Atlantic Rally for Cruisers to sort of engage persons, to sensitize them, to make them aware that once more ARC is coming into town. The crossing normally takes about 10 to 14 days for the first boat to get here. So if we start off on the 25th of November, let's just take like another 10 days and then we have the grand fanfare for the first arrival.
The events company of St. Lucia Inc. and the St. Lucia Tourism Authority continue to encourage the general public to be part of ARC 2018.
So we invite persons to come along and be a part of ARC from the very beginning, even if the boats have not gotten here as yet, but the atmosphere has already started, the hype, the excitement. And at the end of the day, it's not just an activity that is confined within the IGY Rodney Bay Marina, but the economic value, the trickle-down effect goes to, the hotels, the vendors, the supermarkets, the bars, the restaurants, because you have at least 250 boats all descending on St. Lucia between the start of December up until the end.
The ARC participants are scheduled to start trickling into St. Lucia in the next 10 days or 12. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Alex Bousquet.
The St. Lucia National Trust announces the winners of its essay competition. The details when we come back. 10-year-old Shane Edgar, a grade 5 student of the Camille Henry Memorial School, and 15-year-old Dale J.K. Elliott, a Form 4 student of the St. Joseph's Convent, won the primary and secondary school essay competition organized by the St. Lucia National Trust. The students were required to make a case for or against the construction of a dolphin park here. The results were announced at the organization's annual general meeting on Saturday. Here is Don Nicholas with more.
Prizes for the primary and secondary school essay competitions organized by the St. Lucia National Trust included a tablet and wireless speaker kit, Captain Mike's Whale and Dolphin Watching Tour for two persons, and a $100 voucher from Taxi Boutique. 10-year-old Shane Edgar of the Camille Henry Memorial School and 15-year-old Dale J.K. Elliott of the St. Joseph's Convent emerged winners.
We have with us a consultant, Mr. Eve Raynor, who will be going through a presentation on the Trust Strategic Plan, because we want to ensure that going forward we improve on how we do things, and with the support, of course, of partners and our members. Our AGM is open to the general public, not only members, and we're hoping that persons will come and learn firsthand for themselves all about what we do, our conservation work in built and natural heritage, and make a decision on their own.
The annual general meeting of the St. Lucia National Trust entailed a presentation on the organization's strategic plan. The objective is to improve the organization's level of efficiency. At the same time, the Trust is hoping that more persons will join the organization. The meetings are always open to the public.
Also on the agenda, we have the prize award for a competition that was held. It has to do with the dolphinarium, the proposed dolphinarium. We had primary school and secondary school students who wrote an essay either for or against the dolphinarium. And so we have those students with us, and they'll be getting their prizes.
This was annual general meeting number 42 for the St. Lucia National Trust. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The Writing Legend organization is launching what it calls the Giving Tuesday Eastern Caribbean campaign on November 27th. It will feature My Giving Story EC, which is original social media storytelling contest that encourages giving. Participants submit their stories about how and why they give and a cause that they care about. They may also tell a story of a person, family, or organization they would like a donation made to as part of Giving Tuesday. Entries are posted to the social media pages using hashtag MyGivingStoryEC, where they will qualify for the top three places and prizes. Donations will be made to the winning nominees on December 22nd this year. Donations will be made in the form of cash, food, and other items.
And what happens is, if your entry is one of our winners, then the organization that you nominated would actually receive a prize from Giving Tuesday. So we're looking at three main categories for now. We're looking at first the People's Choice, which is based on likes on all our social media platforms, so the entries will be posted there. We're looking at the most collaborative story, which is to recognize group effort, and we're also looking at the most compelling story, which is the one that really moves us and is very impactful.
The contest will run for 3 weeks until December 18th, 2018. All entries are to be posted across the organization's social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, by midnight on December the 11th for voting. You're watching the DBS News World. Sports is next. Finally from us, on the lighter side. Fred Flintstone joined the celebrities in trouble with the law when a sheriff's deputy in Florida pulled him over on November the 4th for speeding in a Wesley Chapel housing development. Police identified the driver as Mr. Fred Flintstone and said his real name is Don Schwartz. He was nabbed in a smart car customized to look like the foot-powered caveman car seen in the 1960s cartoon series, according to a local television station. The sheriff's office said in a Facebook post that Flintstone, also known as Schwartz, became unruly after being issued a speeding citation. He was later released with a notice to appear in court. The post jokes that the prehistoric smart car was seized and is now part of the police fleet. This is what intelligence-led policing looked like in the Stone Age, said the Post, which included pictures of the vehicle and a barefoot driver dressed in Flintstone's garb. Time now for the usual reminder. A grand jury begins hearing the Botham Jean case in Dallas, Texas. Kimberly DeLeon is laid to rest as demands for justice for the slain mother grow louder. The psychological and social well-being of persons living with HIV and TB to get priority. And the Independence Committee plans an entire year of activities to mark the island's 40th independence anniversary. That's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polion, wishing you a very good evening. Good night, and see you next time.